the state-owned farms, modern agricultural methods were employed, and these were based largely around the principles of the Green Revolution. Now, you may have heard about the Green Revolution. The Green Revolution is a system of agriculture that was developed during and after World War II that is credited with saving about a billion people from starvation. The Green Revolution style of farming advocates large-scale monoculture cultivation, meaning one kind of plant over large tracts of land, with a heavy reliance on irrigation, scientific management, synthetic fertilizers, hybridized seeds, and pesticide use. All associated with the Green Revolution, had a tremendous ability to feed many people after World War II. Well, when Cuba took over these farms, when the government took over these farms, they also used Green Revolution techniques to specialize in three crops. Those were tobacco, coffee, and sugarcane. It planted tobacco, coffee, and sugarcane on approximately 50% of all of its farmland. And because this style of agriculture relies heavily on inputs, Cuba used many fossil fuels, fertilizers, and pesticides in order to make this Green Revolution possible on the island. At the time, Cuba's primary trading partner was the Soviet Union, which was also another socialist country. And about 85% of the sugar that Cuba planted and harvested, processed, went to the Soviet Union. And the Soviet Union, in turn, furnished about 70% of Cuba's imports, in particular petroleum. Cuba benefited greatly from this trade through preferential trade prices, meaning they got very good prices for their sugar and relatively low prices on their fossil fuels. Well, by the late 1970s, the reliance on outside resources was starting to cause strain on the agricultural system. So Cuba's farm, relying on these inputs, primarily from the Soviet Union, but also from around the world, in order to specialize in these three crops. By the end of the 1970s, or by the late 1970s, Cuba was using twice as much fertilizer per unit of land as the US. They had approximately four times as much irrigation infrastructure as other countries in this region. They had about twice as much mechanization with its associated fossil fuel needs. Cuba recognized that there were some problems here and some other problems associated with them, and they began to address them through policy changes that came about almost 10 years later in 1986. But at that point, something drastic happened. In 1989, the Soviet Union and its socialist allies dissolved, and Cuba's global socialist support system and agricultural trading partnerships collapsed. At the same time, the United States, which was emboldened by its Cold War success, which caused Soviet Union to collapse, increased the intensity of its embargo on Cuba. Well, Cuba, as a result of losing its trading partners, immediately had a really drastic problem. Their oil imports dropped by 53%, their food imports dropped by 50%, and their fertilizer imports dropped by 83%. This was because their partners throughout the world had collapsed politically at the end of the Cold War. Well, the Cuban government declared something called a special period during peacetime of total austerity. This was sort of a funny way of saying that they were in a panic responding to starvation, which was going on in their country. What this meant was that they were instituting an absolute minimum amount of food rationing to its people, just enough food being distributed that they could keep their people alive given this drastic change in their agricultural situation as a result of their geopolitical partnerships collapse. Well, slowly, for the next 3 years, the Cuban people began to starve. Food availability dropped dramatically. Per capita food consumption dropped 35%. This is comparable to us in our world. If you want to try and put this in some sort of comparison, some sort of way for us to wrap our heads around it, this is comparable to someone in the US having to miss 7 meals per week. It's estimated that during this time, every Cuban lost 20 pounds in this very volatile period of starvation. Just some facts about that. Tubers, so things like potatoes, the production of tubers dropped by 96%. The production of rice dropped by 68%. The price of beef, or I'm sorry, the production of beef dropped by 48%. And yet, if you look forward in time, 10 years later, by the year 2000, Cuba had been able to recover to the nutrient level that they had in 1989. And the question is, how did they do it? And this challenge is at the heart of the case study of Cuba. Well, many of the changes that Cuba undertook at that point were political and economic. Faced with collapse, the Cuban government began to regard food security and food independence as an issue of national security and national sovereignty, something that countries don't usually associate food with national security. So a quote from the unfinished puzzle says, not only was the concern to provide for the nutritional needs of the population, so just getting food to the people, but also to avoid external dependence, especially on multinational corporations that control global commodity markets. So in addition to feeding their people, Cuba wanted to be somewhat independent from the fluctuations in the global food market. Well, subsequently, drastic policy changes were put in place that elevated the prestige and the importance of agriculture, both through technical support and economic incentives and almost propaganda-like messages talking about the value of farmers to the general economy. According to the World Wildlife Fund's Living Planet report, and this is also a quote from Unfinished Puzzle, according to the World Wildlife Fund's Living Planet report in 2006, Cuba is the only country in the world that meets its criteria for an ecological footprint and sustainable development. Even the World Bank, an organization whose policies are at odds with the socialist government in Cuba, acknowledged in 2001 that Cuba is an anti-model. They have some of the best health and education indicators in the developing world. And whether this is a result of government policies or is a fact despite government policies is one of those hotly debated points among the different stakeholders in Cuba's story. Well, fundamentally, what happened during this period is that Cuba, forced to do something other than rely on imported fertilizers and fossil fuels, rejected the Green Revolution paradigm for agriculture. This was instituted just as a pragmatic response because they didn't have the resources to continue to implement the Green Revolution style agriculture. The new agricultural model instead became based on diversification instead of monoculture, meaning many different varieties of a kind of food plant instead of one variety of a food plant. The use of organic fertilizers as opposed to the use of produced or petrochemical-based fertilizers. The use of organic pest control rather than manufactured pesticides or artificial synthetically manufactured pesticides. The use of local resources and local development instead of external dependencies. The decentralization of land assignment, markets, and decision-making. Now, this was a little bit of a rejection of some of the socialist principles as a necessity to get rapid response on the ground. This was an approach taken in opposition to central control, which is sort of an important part of Cuban socialism. The last point that they adopted was food self-sufficiency instead of relying on imports. Well, a huge part of these changes weren't just policy and economic, but they are also based on implementing urban agriculture. The state provided many avenues of support for urban agriculture, but a really pivotal one was the transformation and redistribution of state lands to the workers in something that was called usufruct, U-S-U-F-R-U-C-T. And this became known as the third agrarian reform in Cuba. The first one distributed large farms, repatriated large farms. The second one repatriated or nationalized medium farms. This third one changed the way that the farms were managed and held. In this case, usufruct was a limited relaxation of state ownership and instead allowed private individuals to own them. It allowed Cubans to be in charge of land, the root term being usus, U-S-U-S. So it allowed them to be in charge of the land, usus, and derive a profit from it. That's derived from the concept of fructus, F-R-U-C-T-U-S, but didn't allow them to sell it or to change its use as a farm. And this third component is what's necessary for a full, for a Western sense of full ownership of land. So Cubans were allowed to be in charge of the land, they were allowed to make a profit of the land, but they were not allowed to change its use, and they were not allowed to sell it. Well, 60% of state lands were given to workers to farm the land in usufruct. And the workers were allowed to set up models of urban agriculture that were known as basic units of cooperative production. The Spanish language acronym for that is UBPC. One of the key reasons why this approach was embraced by the population was because they were allowed to keep what they farmed. And so this was a way to avoid the slow starvation that was happening as a result of the lack of imports to keep the Green Revolution alive. So although this, although the farming that they were undertaking had to be done in addition to the other state work that they were responsible for. So subsequently, they were allowed to keep the profits from extra produce and the produce itself that they sold. So they were allowed to keep the food, eat it, benefit from it. They were also allowed to sell their extra produce on a limited free market, usually a local kind of free market. And this picture here is one of the stands in which those that produce was allowed to be sold. So for comparison, before the collapse, Cuba produced 250,000 tons of rice using high input methods. And after that collapse, it went from 250,000 tons down to 80,000 tons. That was what the collapse caused. Well, in this quote from our unfinished business book, in 1994, post-UBPC, in both rural and urban areas, a movement emerged in which people began planting rice everywhere they could, especially on marginal lands, such as on roadsides, in medians. Within just 4 years, the production of this popular rice had surpassed the production of specialized rice by 16%. So just to reiterate that, in the context of collapse, the Cuban people planted rice on any land that they could find, and the result of that was this urban guerrilla architecture, this urban guerrilla agriculture began producing more rice than was being produced through the formal large-scale farming methods. Currently, popular rice supplies about 35% of rice consumption. So the rice grown in all the nooks and crannies of the environment, that's about 35% of the rice consumption in Cuba today. Well, by 2007, urban and peri-urban agriculture, so peri-urban agriculture meaning agriculture in a ring or the area at the edge of the cities, on the outside of the cities, that kind of agriculture, urban and peri-urban agriculture, produced more than 75% of the fresh vegetables consumed in Cuba.